I'm Judy Gelman Myers with Shalom TV's New Jewish Cinema, and I'm here with Michael King, the director of this incredible documentary called The Rescuers, about European diplomats who defied the rules, often at risk to their careers and even their lives, to save their fellow men.
Kigali has been the center of the fiercest fighting in the Civil War. The United Nations has been able to do very little to help these people.
As a Rwandan and an anti-genocide activist who lost many members of my family to genocide, I could not think of a better project to be part of than one that shows how all of us can make a difference.
My father was a young diplomat in 1943. My father was told to stop giving these passports and helping the Jewish community escape the island.
German planes.
My mother was thrown to the ground and she died the following Saturday.
Duckwitz, a member of the Nazi Party, had by his efforts organized the rescue of 7,200 people. An amazing feat of goodness from someone who had been trained in the art of evil.
I feel so peculiar standing here with you because you're alive.
It is terrible that so many people had to die where 600,000 Jews lived before, and at the end of the war, 90,000 has left to live.
You don't connect these bureaucratic actions to the actual saving of a life.
Yeah. Not when you see you, though.
What would you say to Frank Foley today if you met him?
Thank you for saving our lives. Thank you.
When you reflect on the diplomats, the phrase, the mystery of goodness, is it a mystery, or do you think goodness is actually a deep-seated human virtue which emerges?
I know there can be hope. I've learned that when we see crimes against humanity, we cannot turn the other way. Instead, we must transform our fears into courage to take action.
Michael, welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, thank you, Judy. You for being with us. You make music videos, documentaries, and features, including a music video based on Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech, a documentary about youth violence in America featuring Chuck D, and another doc called Rapping with Shakespeare. How did you come to make The Rescuers?
The genesis behind The Rescuers was when I'm not making films, I'm a professor of films. I was teaching in Florida, and a good friend whose family has been very instrumental in my development as a filmmaker from my early years, almost 20 years. The Mandel family from West Hartford, Connecticut, Joyce Mandel particularly, called me up about a photo exhibit she saw on Ellis Island. And about these diplomats who risked their lives, risked their families, risked their careers, and went against their country policies to save thousands and thousands of Jewish lives and others, for that matter. She told me that it was a very heartfelt, emotional testimonial. People were crying. It was very moving. And she thought it would be good be a good documentary for us to explore. Joyce was the funder for my previous documentaries, Bangin', Teenage Sex, Breaking Silence, Sex is Not a Four-Letter Word, Rapping with Shakespeare, and this would make our fourth film together, our collaboration. First film, Bangin', I won an Emmy for, and it kind of set up the relationship to the rescuers in this long period of time between us. So I did some research. I researched the subject matter, about the Holocaust. I also researched about these individual diplomats. And went to Yad Vashem with the help of Sir Martin. They were able to open up their archives for me because the majority of the rescuers are righteous Gentiles. Mm-hmm. And so each one of them had testimonials from survivors. And these survivors were the ones I was able to get in contact with. Some of them have passed away, some were too old to respond. And there were a couple that, you know, that were very interested from each of the survivors to give their appreciation and tell their story,
yeah.
Their individual stories. I told Joyce, I said, this is a wonderful story. This needs to be told.
Yeah.
These people were marginalized. These were people were drummed out of the diplomatic corps. And a personal story is that I grew up in Connecticut, and I went to school with Hiram Bingham's son, Billy
wow.
Bingham. So that I had a personal connection to the story. And Joyce thought it over. It was a very expensive production, as you can see, in terms of production value. We took a train through Europe with Sir Martin. We filmed in Europe. We filmed in Israel, we filmed in Africa. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity to tell the story.
Now, how did Stephanie Nyumbare, who is a Rwandan anti-genocide activist, come on board?
Good question. I found Stephanie on the internet. And Sir Martin and I were talking, and
this is Sir Martin Gilbert, the renowned Holocaust historian.
That's right. He's written over 80 books. Mm-hmm. He's the biographer for Winston Churchill, and he was my teacher and mentor for the last 4 or 5 years. He's an incredible human being. Stephanie, Sir Martin and I were talking, and because so many of my films are youth based and have a youth culture to it. So wouldn't it be wonderful if we could find you an assistant to go on the road while you're researching this? And so I found Stephanie on the internet, and her story was very compelling. She lost 100 members of her family in the Rwandan genocide. She came to the United States, went to school in Connecticut, a private school, graduated from Swarthmore College, started an anti-genocide network in Washington, D.C., and was an advocate. I asked her to give Sir Martin a call and for them to talk and see if it made sense for them to get together and for him to go on this journey with him. In the beginning of the film, you see the letter that she wrote to him initially to introduce herself. And that's how the relationship started. We started with her initial trip to London to meet with Sir Martin, and the story begins.
Yeah. Sir Martin repeatedly used the phrase, the mystery of goodness, to talk about these men who really, as you said, broke their country's rules to save their fellow men. Did he ever answer the question of what is the mystery of goodness? Why some people are moved to behave in that fashion and others are moved to behave in an evil fashion?
The short answer is probably not. But there is something inspiring about us examining what makes one do the right thing and one do nothing.
Yes.
And trying to find that epistemology, that belief system, that core belief that makes people want to be rescuers. And some people be inactive and do nothing. And I think that the mystery of goodness is all within us because we're born good. What happens, it's in our DNA. What happens to us as we develop? What corrupts us? What makes us not want to do the right thing? And I think everybody, the challenge is for everybody to look within themselves, to find the goodness, and beyond knowing it's there, but do something about it.
Right.
So it's a call of action.
Okay. Some of the rescuers, like Raoul Wallenberg, are very well known. Others, like Selahattin Ulkunen, were not, a Turkish Muslim. Can you talk about his story? I was very, very moved by that, and I think the people should know his story.
Yeah, that's a very powerful story. Selahattin Ulkunen, a Turkish diplomat, was responsible for saving a lot of lives in Rhodes during World War II. Rhodes is an island, for those that don't know, off Greece. His wife was pregnant with their first child. And he was repeatedly told by the Germans not to provide visas to the Jewish citizenship in Rhodes. He continued. They decided that in retaliation for that, they would bomb the embassy. His wife was severely injured.
And during the bombing?
During the bombing. There was a choice to be made between her and the baby. The baby was born. Here's a story of an individual, a diplomat, doing the right thing, risking his life, his family's life, going against his country's policy, and saving as many lives as he could.
People should also know the story of Chiuni Sugihara, who is Sylvia Smoller's rescuer. He was a Japanese
diplomat. And that's a tragic story with a very tragic ending.
Yes.
And never really getting recognized again. These stories, Sugihara's story, Ulkunen's story, was washed away because they went against their country policy. In the case of Sugihara, they even filed the letters, the requests, the evidence that he made in terms of trying to change policy. Hmm. And it's sad because that type of historic documentation would give us insight into the mystery of goodness. Sugihara, along with Swedendijk from Holland, devised a plan to liberate many of the Lithuanian Jews during World War II. Sugihara, after doing that, was ostracized. It was marginalized from his diplomatic duties. He went into poverty and died a very sad, sad life.
Yeah, I mean, he essentially became a porter hauling stuff at the
railroad station.
At the railroad station.
Absolutely. And that's another, it's very emotional when I talk about these stories.
And upsetting,
you know, that for doing such a courageous, heroic, humanitarian action, that he was driven into being homeless and living out of a one-room apartment and never getting recognized until later when he was considered designated righteous by Yad Vashem.
Mm-hmm. One of the rescuers, George Dukwitz, was a member of the Nazi Party who flew to Berlin to protest the deportation of the Danish Jews and then persuaded the king, the Swedish king, to accept them. That, I mean, certainly
he saved
most people don't know that story either.
Exactly. You know, there was one good German, what can I say? And he saved 90% of the Danish Jewry. And a very courageous individual that knew that he had to do the right thing. He went to Hitler. He went to Germany and basically protested the final solution and was told that it was going to happen, and on his way back decided that he would do everything within his power to make sure to save as many lives as possible. So he went to the Swedish king and made arrangements for the Jews of Denmark to have a place to go.
And what happened to him after?
He became the diplomat under the West German government, and it stayed in Denmark. So he in this case he was rewarded and not penalized because of his actions, and stayed in the diplomatic corps.
Wow.
And it's still considered within the German, the current, the modern day, post-Nazi era, considered one of their celebrated diplomats for his actions and what he did.
Is he considered one of the righteous Gentiles at
Yes,
Yad Vashem?
Yes, he is.
Interesting. There is a fascinating scene where Stephanie is talking to this young German diplomat about taking action, and he kept saying, "Words are all we have."
Right.
Can you? That was a very bizarre scene. Can you talk about what was going on there?
I think it was very, you know, the German diplomat was staying within his boundaries of what he's been taught, and it's obviously. He didn't really, I would hope, deal really, that's not the way he really feels about in terms of saving lives and what they can do or where his powers as a diplomat are beyond just the rules, but also is to be active in saving lives.
Mm-hmm.
That should be part of the rules. Even though not explicit, it should be implicit in terms of him as a diplomat and why I would think he wants to be in the diplomatic corps.
Right.
Is to make a difference. And not just stick to the letter of diplomacy that he's been taught. So it was very cold, it was very harsh, it was very inhuman, and yeah, what can I say? I'm sure he regrets what he said, but he did say it. But it speaks to a larger issue, huh? He represents, that statement represents so many other diplomats that were inactive and allowed the Holocaust and other genocides to happen without having a voice, being silent.
Right.
And that goes to the UN in a lot of cases. You know, when you think about it, I mean, the Holocaust is one of many genocides.
Absolutely.
Over 100 million people died in the 20th century from genocide activities. And so, and when you think about that number, who is there protecting these innocent? These are non-combatant individuals. Human beings, who's protecting their rights? So I think that German diplomat represents not just on his own voice, but a lot of other diplomats out there.
Mm-hmm. It was so weird. It was like 70 years after the fact, and he's saying, well, I'm just following orders
right.
all over again and without having learned anything from history.
Right, and then praising, and ironically, and he's praising Duke. You know, so how, you know, try to figure that one out.
Yeah.
One minute you're praising this individual for saving lives, and you're telling his story to us, but then again, you're insulting him by saying, I haven't learned the lesson.
Right, right. Sir Martin Gilbert at one point outlined the four solutions: Eichmann's program of emigration, then ghettoization, then mass murder with the Einsatzgruppen, and the final solution. I've never heard that framework. Do you know if that was his own, or if was that that actually articulated by the Nazis? First solution, second solution, third solution.
I think it was articulated by the Nazi. I can't speak for Sir Martin, but he was very eloquent in that
yeah.
sequence. And it was a very powerful scene. For those who haven't seen it, I hope you will. But I mean, it was very difficult for him to go in that place where they did the planning. Where they sat there.
Wannsee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Wannsee Villa.
Yeah.
Outside Berlin. And decided on how they were going to do, how they were going to exterminate the Jewish race. And that's the day that we shot the film. I could see it in his face that this wasn't going to be an easy day.
Mm.
I mean, and you're talking about somebody that lost his family in the Holocaust. You're talking lost friends, relatives, and walking into this evil, eerie villa.
Did you feel it?
To relive what was going on at that moment of time. Yes, I felt it. I shot it as I felt it. Opening up the doors slamming. Him. Looking at the criminals who put this action in plan, talking about each one of them, from Eichmann all the way down.
But oddly enough, Hitler's picture wasn't it?
No.
I mean, because he wasn't at Wannsee.
No. But he's mentioned.
Yeah.
It will never be forgotten.
Yeah. The archival footage that you got is really, really amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah, can you talk about your choices and how you got the footage?
Well, I mean, when we reconstruct that period of time, it was based on Sir Martin's narration. It was based on the survivors that went back to the countries they escaped from, and also on that historical time frame. We were able to reach out to all the archival houses within each separate country
wow.
that we filmed at, and also from the United States, from the Holocaust Museum and at Yad Vashem, and also the one here, the United States Holocaust Museum. And we were able then to make selections based on the survivors' time frame, Sir Martin's narration again. It was a lengthy process. We had a researcher that went through all the footage, and then we mapped out which shots for which scene, for which period.
What was the most difficult point in the shoot for you?
Very good question. When I went to the Pinari Forest, I don't know if you remember that scene.
Yeah,
that's a very eerie scene. I walked in there by myself just to set it up. We're in a forest with 100 feet pine trees, 200 feet pine trees overlooking this forest. Railroad station by the side of the forest. There's three large pits in the forest that the Nazis used to murder hundreds of thousands of Jews. They would put them in the pit, and they would machine gun them. Some did survive, very few, and crawled through the forest. Hearing the train, the echoing of the train and the voices through the woods was very powerful within my imagination, within my mind, with me reconstructing the scene from history. And so my initial instinct was to just film it as is, and from looking down into the grave, into the pit, and then I decided I wanted to look at the trees because the trees were a witness to what happened. Mm. So when we went in to the pit, it was surreal. I felt the spirits. The pit was untouched, so it wasn't like marbleized, memorialized. It was the actual pit. Ooh. With the moss, with snow, with the shadows of the tree, and that particular scene affected me. And it's been a long journey, but I'm so proud that it's part of my legacy.
Absolutely. What's going to happen with the film now? Have you taken it to the UN at all?
We had last year, January, we had a screening at the UN where 500 diplomats came to the screening.
And what was the reaction?
Very powerful. It's a powerful, emotional film.
Yeah, tremendous.
And it's inspirational for us to learn a lesson about these diplomats and also look inside ourselves.
Absolutely. Is there anything that you want to add?
No, it's just a pleasure being here, and hopefully everybody will support the film, and you can look at our website. The rescue is doc.com.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
All right.
I'm Judy Gelman Myers with Shalom TV's New Jewish Cinema, and I've been speaking with Michael King, director of this extraordinary documentary, The Rescuers. Thank you, and thank you, Michael.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double high or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM. To JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.